All right, we are back and it's still Crossfire with Dakpo Anishoma. We have Gbola Oba with us in the studio. Now, let me quickly, in rounding up, with the story that we started with, let me quickly read a report and then let's take your reaction and then we can go. Now, the presidency has reacted to allegations that's been going on about a plot to rig the upcoming governorship election in Kogi and Bayelsa state, respectively. Now, reports have emanated in some quarters that there were plots to rig the forthcoming election following a recent meeting between President Muhammadu Buhari, the chairman of the Independent National Electoral Commission, and the police. However, reacting to these insinuations, Malam Garba Shehu, the president's special assistant on media and publicity, denied the claim, saying that it would accept the outcome of the elections, whatever happens. Now, we have been reliably told that, INEC is supposed to conduct the elections independently. And the meeting, as a matter of fact, was supposedly, conducted because the president just wanted to meet the main parties, that will coordinate the elections. That is INEC in itself, and then for security purposes and coordination, the Nigerian police. And that this particularly was not in the bid to send a wrong signal to the entire, especially to Kogi State and Bayelsa State and the stakeholders, and especially to Nigerians. Now, but the issue is that, as the president, are we saying that the president cannot, in any way put aside his partisanship and then address INEC and the representation of the Nigerian police on the conduct of, the elections in Kogi and Bayelsa State?
Let me give you two scenarios and tell me which one would be more effective.
Okay.
The president, through Garba Shehu, gathers senior journalists of all the major media organizations in this country, from online to onshore, print to electronic, whatever, gathers them in the conference room in Abuja and coherently articulates his fairness and implores the senior journalist to please go to their media organizations and quote him verbatim that he wants a well-conducted
elections.
That is one scenario. Now, just oppose that scenario with the seemingly opaque scenario that the president invited the INEC chair.
It wasn't a press conference, really.
I'm just opposing.
Yes, I get what you
mean. I'm just opposing transparency with opacity.
Exactly.
And you know one thing opacity does? Opacity fuels
insinuations,
rumors, and this thing. Garba Shehu has failed the president of this subject. You should go and keep quiet. I'm talking as a Nigerian.
Okay.
And it's my right also to hold an opinion.
Garba Shehu, as a senior advisor
to the president, especially on an issue that borders on his portfolio, has grandiosely failed this president on this subject. You should keep quiet.
So he's trying to give a justification. This particular statement he's making is more like giving a justification for whatever mistake.
I gave two scenarios.
And we know the one that definitely is fair, free, credible, and we send the right signal to Nigerians to say the president doesn't mean any harm, but what the president simply wants is a transparent,
That would have been more effective. Because imagine your senior news editor, he had invited senior news editor of the major newspapers of the district, and the president stands before them, gentlemen and ladies, thank you for coming to Abuja. I just want to use this opportunity to reiterate the fact that I'm predisposed to seeing INEC and the law enforcement agencies. You can even call INEC there with the journalist, call the law enforcement agencies, conducting a respectable elections that will give credibility to our country.
Let me ask this question quickly.
We need to go to some other story.
Before you went on
before we went on the first break, you said something about the PDP emerging as a strong opposition. Now, in advanced climbs, no, he talked about he mentioned that. Now, in advanced climbs, we've seen that the opposition, they fuel the ruling party, they spur them to working because of the criticisms which, you know, the table before them. Now, do you think the PDP, with all of these issues and, you know, some of the mistakes we're seeing the APC, you know, perform, do you think the PDP can put so much fire on the APC's heels to make them step up their game? Do you think this PDP is capable?
Are we going to likely have a stronger opposition than PDP by 2019?
Maybe another political party.
The issue we are talking about now, which organization brought it to the fore, which organization is alleging a plot to rig? Is it not the PDP?
It's the PDP.
But you see, I want to say at this juncture that the fortunes of the PDP is so bad, and they are going through what I've stated, or what I've called their pariahhood state now. But you see, pariahhood status does not last forever. Mm-hmm. And like I said earlier on, opposition parties don't win elections, ruling parties lose them. Look, I was an avid APC supporter during the electioneering campaigns. A number of things have made me know that I'm not still an APC supporter relative to PDP. The PDP don't even configure in my radar as we speak now. But when the APC keeps making or dropping the ball, you know, at every critical junction, it took almost 6 months to appoint ministers, took almost 6 months to appoint INEC commissioners. As we speak now, the INEC executive has 5 federal commissioners instead of 13 or 17. And things are being done in a slapdash manner, to be honest with you.
I think the presidency went zonal.
Yeah.
In the appointment of the...
Even if the presidency needed to go not only zonal, not only state by state, even if the presidency wants to go by local government to local government, indeed, family to family, Nigeria has enough competent people. Competent people and morally solid people to constitute any this thing.
All right, we have to really drop this story now at this point. Let's quickly talk about now. We have 36 portfolioed ministers already, and they've been, many of them have already, you know, resumed. They've gone to their ministries, and as far as I'm concerned, I believe very strongly
we're
waiting to see results. Now, I want us to begin to look at, okay, now they have their portfolio, they have been given responsibilities, the president is, expecting that as soon as possible result, you know, we start coming in, since there is a lot of work to be done. Mm-hmm. Now, let's look at the Nigerian economy. Let's talk about transportation, let's talk about education, let's talk about, agriculture, education, transportation, power, works, housing, health. You know, we have a lot of the economy of Nigeria, almost all of them are not doing well. We still have people being transferred out of the country, they can't use our health facility. Mm-hmm. We have agriculture that we're expecting to be, Nigerians, you know, next economy mainstay, if really and truly the government want to diversify like they've been singing. And then we have the educational system. Recently, Godwin Akpabio came out really very strong to be telling us the reason why we don't send our daughters to Nigerian university and we send them abroad is the fact that we don't want lecturers. Can you imagine such a statement to molest them? So what happens to my daughter? What happens to your daughter? What happens to all our young ladies who are attending university? You are simply discrediting the educational system in Nigeria as not credible. And as far as I'm concerned,
the good thing is that his party had 16 years to correct that.
And nothing was done.
And nothing tangible was done.
Now, let's quickly talk about this, Gbola Oba. I'm beginning to feel there have been a lot of push from the business, you know, angle. You as an entrepreneur, and I am just a journalist, a Nigerian who is looking forward to, you know, to making it also, either career wise or I do one business or the other. Now, my concern is, should the focus of government be to start creating enabling environment for business to thrive, or government really want to cushion the effect of the 16 years of Nigerians not being able to live a normal life. I mean, poverty level was measured over 16 years, since 1999. We've not been able to see any meaningful life, given environment for Nigerians. Now, what should be the focus of this new government? Now we have ministers, we have the Federal Executive Council, all of them are supposed to begin to look at how to move Nigeria forward. Which area of the Nigerian economy should government start looking at?
I need to approach answering your question with some rhetorical questions.
Okay, sir.
Is it sustainable for government to just be putting monies in the hands of people who are not adding direct value or creating value within an economy? I don't know any.
Is that why APC does not want to pay the 5,000 naira promise to Nigerians?
Who are these people who are not adding value? I think Nigerians want to know.
He asked me a question by juxtaposing in a conflicting way, by portraying in a conflicting way the role of business and the role of the people.
I hope you are not reacting to this as a businessman. I
naturally would react to it as a businessman. I will not say, you know me, I don't lie.
Yes, I know. Because my posture already is...
My posture... Look, my brother and my sister, the largest employer anywhere in the world, in any reasonable economy where sustainability is entrenched, is not the government. Mm-hmm. It's not. People can go and independently check their facts. In virtually all the societies where prosperity can easily be gleaned, the engine, the greatest, most potent engine of prosperity is actually private sector enterprises. And you want me to shock you? Not even the so-called blue chip behemoths, the mom and pop businesses, the SMEs, as we call them in Nigeria.
Small and medium enterprises.
Somebody like you, who decides, or when you see a niche that most of the ladies in my church on Sunday wear beautiful, aesthetically enriched hats. And, whilst still being a barrister, whilst still being a broadcaster, you will just look for some women who have the gift of doing it, but who don't have the link, the direct link with the market. Because you bring the market nearer to them, their skill set will be rewarded. You will make money. Those who buy the hats will be happy. Any government anywhere in the world that does not give priority to making sure that the larger percentage of this population acquires marketable skill sets. That's the primary emphasis of the government. When people have marketable skill sets, the number of Togolese, the number of Beninois that are now seen on construction sites in Lagos will reduce, and Nigerians will feel those. And our boys will stop doing Okada, which is not only inimical to their health, but which ordinarily will not give them sustainable. So what the government needs to do on the side of the people, one, I will encourage the federal government to quickly articulate a welfare system that will make the government give money directly to the hands of indigent Nigerians as an incentive for skills acquisition. I will give you 5,000 naira as an unemployed graduate. I will give you 5,000 naira as a retrenched worker. I will give you 5,000 naira as an unemployed school leaver. I will give you 5,000 naira as an unemployed bona fide Nigerian for 1.5 to 2 years. Within that 1.5 to 2 years, let me give you some traits where you have multiple, some industries where you have multiple traits.
Can you hold on that thought? Let's quickly take this call. Good morning, Alex.
Good morning, Barista. Good morning, Dakbo.
Good morning,
how are you
Alex.
Today?
And I believe you have a resource person in the house. Good morning as well.
Good morning. Yeah, we have Mr. Gbola Oba in the studio.
One of my mentors.
Thank you.
Gbola Oba is here.
Thank you, my brother.
Okay, are we looking at extending largesse to the unemployed?
No, we initially talked about the Kogi and Bayelsa elections and the role APC is playing and the perception of PDP in that. And then we are talking about which area of the Nigerian economy should the Federal Executive Council, now that it's been fully constituted, where should they focus on?
It's priority.
Engineer Dakpo, I've always maintained that there are agricultural potential, solid mineral potential. These areas are begging to be optimally taxed. At least let us deviate a little bit from the oil and gas. Sure. And because the oil and gas, we see what the market situation is internationally.
Yeah.
$41 per barrel. So that left the government with very mean resources to operate with. So if we are talking of, you see, the Kogi election, for instance, the anti-corruption posture of the present APC will be called to question, considering that APC, the governing candidate, is indicted by ESCC. The former ESCC boss, Lamo, they actually advised Buhari that the guy should not be fed by APC, and today the man is contesting. So it makes those of us who are supportive of the change agenda to be wary the intention of the present APC. Will Buhari be able to make a difference as a sole fighter in APC? So, believe me, it calls to so many questions. Today, how do Abubakar, a former governor, is ruling, he's contesting. In fact, he brings a lot of questions to the corruption posture of the APC. So, I want to believe, I'm looking forward to a fully militarized government chief election in Kogi State. In fact, it's going to test how far the present INEC goes will handle the elections in the country. So, it should do it well, give it to whoever that wins that election without interfering from any quarter at all. The present INEC goes to imitate his predecessor, Atahi Rujega, who stood his ground. He should not be swayed by anything at all.
Okay.
So, that is my little take this morning.
Thank you so much, Alex. Thank you so much, and have a beautiful day.
Thank you very much, Tammy, for your contribution. Let's quickly go on a short break now. When we come back, we'll be approaching the last lap of the show. We'll still be talking to Mr. Gbola Oba. All right, we are back, and it's still CROSSFIRE with Dakpo and Ishioma. We have Mr. Gbola Oba in the studio. Now, you were making
so
a point.
I said I will encourage the government to put that 5,000 naira or 10,000 naira. To me, even 5,000 naira is not a living stipend.
Yes, it's not at all.
You know, but 10,000 naira, 15,000 naira, 20,000 naira, I put it in your hand and tell you, within the context of you drawing this money for 1.5 to 2 years, we have this program on how to become a farmer, vegetable farmer,
cash crop farmer.
Tomato is part of vegetables.
Yeah.
You know, because I have a vegetable. This thing. Now, if you're not interested in agriculture, we have these traits in construction. In construction, you have foundation molding. You have bricklaying. You have bricklaying. You have plastering. You have tiling, you have this. In construction, there are about 16 traits that people could learn under 6 months. Under 6 months. And you'll be very good once your passion and diligence are invested in it.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't want to do agriculture, you don't want to do construction, we have automotive traits. I run an automotive training institute. I produce auto-diagnosticians in less than 3 months, and they use it to live and live comfortably. You can learn tire and wheel care skill sets, being a modern vulcanizer who also knows how to do wheel balancing and alignment in less than 3 months. Mm-hmm. So I will put this thing in your hand. You'll be doing it for 1.5 years. Mm-hmm. At the end of 1.5 years, whatever skill set you have learned, I will join you in your area with some other persons who have learned the same skill set, yeah, and give you a seed funding to form a cooperative.
Hmm. Okay.
My brother, you are turning an erstwhile unemployed person a baggage to society. You are turning him into an entrepreneur. There should be no conflict between the business community and a well-designed government policy wishing to benefit the majority of Nigerians. Because the conduit pipe out of impoverishedness is actually entrepreneurialism. Hmm. If somebody believes that...
Which ministries are you expecting should come together now to actually, to actualize this particular dream for Nigerians?
I was actually thinking the other day that if I were Fashola, I will get some good skills mentors in the area of construction, and bring a number of young Nigerian graduates to understudy
these individuals.
To understudy ongoing, I would say, if you are building any road for the federal government, you must in your staff, we will pay them, you don't bother.
But they
you
have
must
to
in your staff have maybe 5% young graduates that
fresh
we will deploy to you.
Unemployed graduates. Okay.
The federal government will pay them.
Yeah.
Whilst they are there, helping as many jobs or whatever, depending on their level of IQ.
They must be exposed to the skills of how to actually...
They will also collaboratively be undertaking some courses in basic construction, this thing.
Hmm.
In 3 to 6 months, those people will become value adders to those companies.
Okay.
Once that company finishes that project and they want to roll on to another project, some of the people that were given to them as free labor, interns,
yes,
some of them will be deployed because the companies will have seen, I am building a chain across Nigeria today, a franchise chain across Nigeria, because young graduates come, we train them both in the classroom, train them on the workshop floor, and amongst them, I will see this is going somewhere. The boy who is doing automatic radio program now in Abeokuta, the boy who is doing automatic radio program in Abuja, and they are heads, technical heads of our workshop. Boys across Lagos, the boy who is going to start automatic shop in this thing, they came to us as young, unemployed, skill set deficient graduates. The young lady who now runs 2 viable businesses in the greater Abuja area, as of last year, she made a net margin for herself. After drawing 150,000 naira monthly as salary, she made 7.4 million naira for herself. She was the one that employed us to start the second shop with her husband who resigned from an auditing firm. Nigerians are not stupid.
Okay.
If good government policies are in place. And when government, apart from putting in place good government policies, they must know to interface and relate with genuine entrepreneurs who want to give value to make money. There are some people who, as soon as you call them to come and do government project, they just see a free loot.
Mm-hmm.
They get the money, they walk away. Those kids, they don't bother to train.
Hmm.
So the failure... Good luck, Ebele Jonathan did not fail as a president because there were no good ideas on the table. Monitoring was weak as Jonathan was weak. And because monitoring was weak, every plutocrat You know what I mean? Every plutocrat. who was donning the gap of an entrepreneur was stealing the nation drive.
And this is the area Mr. President needs to focus on.
Anyway, I wish that we could actually continue, Mr. Gbola Oba. This is a very interesting one, and I think we should actually bring you back, you know, to actually complete this. Maybe Thursday or Friday, where we can actually be seen on the terrestrial and really, really talk to Nigerian youth, and let's see how far we can go with this. This is how far we can go on the show today. Thanks so very much, Mr. Gbola Oba. We'd like to have you back in our studio. Thanks, Ishoma, for making it so real today. Join us tomorrow morning for another very interesting episode. We'll be back, and you stay out of trouble. God bless Nigeria.
Say no to violence.
So, did you like what you just saw? I know you did. It's very simple. If you want to see more, just subscribe to our channel right now.